this daf of today contain many, many subjects. It's the daf, it's the page 51 in Tractate Gittin. I'd like to start with Ktav Sofer. Ktav Sofer was a great rabbi in Hungary, son of the Chatam Sofer. So he said there are two conflicted, or appear conflicted, psukim. In one place they said, Matza Isha, Matza Tov. If one found a wife, he found good. The other location it's written, King Solomon said in the book of Ecclesiastes, Motze ani mar mimavet et ha'isha, and I found the wife to be embittered in death. So you see here conflicted sources. So Ktav Sofer explains beautifully. He said, if someone married for the purpose of building a family, for the purpose of fulfilling the mitzvah of fruitful and multiplies, then matza isha, matza tov. If someone is in the search of ha'isha, ha'isha he wants because of her money, because of her beauty, because of whatever it is, then he warns us, motze ani mar mimavet. It can be a very bitter ending. Anyway, today we're going to speak not only about those issues, we are going to speak also about Maaser Ksafim, someone who take a tithe of his income. And the question posted to the late Rav Feinstein, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, can the father of a family pay the school tuition from the Maaser Ksafim, from the money to put aside for tithe? Because the obligation by Halacha is up to the age of 6. How about inherited to a daughter's? So you know, biblically the son gets the Yerusha, the inheritance. The rabbis came in and talk about 10% giving to the daughter. What happened is that some cases the father inherited to a daughter with the condition that they get married, etc., for the wedding expenses, dowry, and they don't get married. So the question is that money, if they still have the access, especially if it's more than one daughter, how you treat it? We in general are going to discuss the subject of Bari Veshema, if you have something that is clear and something that you're not sure, how you treat it. But the first subject is Reuven stole from Shimon a property. And after he stole from Shimon the property, he sold it to Levi. And Levi innocently invested a lot of money of improvement of that property. He planted the trees, he did the produce, he did a lot of work. Shimon came in and collected the estate because it's his. And now it's a rabbinic court case of a disputation between Levi requires Shimon to compensate him for all his expense. Shimon called that, I do agree that the property needs improvement, but I will not go to your expense. I am willing to compensate so and so. How you treated this? So let's start, Mitzvah Shem, at the page 50b, 13 lines from the bottom of the page. So the Mishnah, the Holy Mishnah said, En motzi'in la'achilat perot. So they said that they did not appropriate lien of the property that had been sold to a third party for the consumption of produce. Mipnei tikkun ha'olam. So they said, he take the collection of the produce from the robber and not from the estate that the robber sold to other people. Because the commitment between the seller to pay for this produce is not written in the contract. The Meiri explained that it's applied also to the shvach karkaot, to the improvement of the estate. Amar le Rabbi Abba Leula v'ham mazon ha'isha v'abanot dichman dichti v'idamu. He said, but isn't the sustenance of a man's wife and daughters considered as if it is were written? V'katane en motziin. And we learned that it cannot collect, be collected from the husband's lien property. Amar lei hatam, over there, the obligation to pay for the wife and the daughters, all the expenses, is meikara hache itkun. That's the way the sages instituted. Ktuvin hen etzel bnei chorin. It's considering as ktuvim, even it's not written in the ktubah, only in regards to collection of the free, unlien estate, which is the husband's estate that was not sold, because now it's in the hand of the heirs. Ve'en ktuvin hen etzel meshuabadim. But it's not considered as it was written with regard to a lien property that has been sold to another party. Now, we're going now to this discussion between two other Amoraim. V'chen amar Rabbi Asi, amar Rabbi Yochanan. The reason that we do not collect for the produce and the improvement of the estates, lefi she'en ktuvin, which means it's not written in the contract. Amar le Rabbi Zera le Rav Asi v'amazon ha'isha v'abanot dichman dichti v'idamu v'katan ein motziin. Amar le meikar ha'achi itkun ktuvin l'etzel mechorin v'en ktuvin l'etzel meshuabadim. So, in short, it's a concern here that originally it was written as a estate written for that estate, Karkaot Bnei Chorin, but it's not written with regard to a lien property that has been sold to another party. Now, there are many avenues. The Rashba said that this is another avenue to understand the Mishnah. And here we go to disputation. One school of thought is Rabbi Hanina. Rabbi Hanina amar lefi she'ein ktsuvin. Those commitments of the produce, the improvement of the estates, the sustenance of the wife and the daughters, it's a matter that have no clear budget. When you sell the estate, you do not know how much money all this debt will be. When it's produce, when it's improvement of estates, we don't know what's the value of those produce and how much this estate will be after the improvement. Person doesn't know in advance how much money it costs the wife, the daughter in the future, how many children they'll have. So, Ibaya Lehu, Le Rabbi Hanina, Ktsuvin Uchtuvin Bai. According to Rabbi Hanina, in order to collect from lien property, is it necessary that the obligation be both of a fixed amount and also written? If so, this will indicate that Rabbi Hanina adds another requirement in addition to that of Rabbi Yochanan. So Rashi explains that this is a milveh al peh. Tosfot bring the Rabbeinu Tam. He said it can be dvarim achirim. For example, imagine a man married someone and she said, I have a daughter from the previous marriage and I want you to support her for 5 years. So That's basically katsuv. It's already budgeting for 5 years. But when it's come to milveh, alpe, you need to have something that it's mitparsem, something that people hear. So here, what we said here, in order for the noshe, for the collector, that he can collect from those lien property, Rabbi Hanina required that the money will be both budgeted to ktuvim and also written in the contract. 51, or dilma, or perhaps, in order to collect from a lien property, ktsufin aval pishen ktuvim. It can be fixed amount even if it's not written. So it's a book called Chavat Da'at. Chavat Da'at explains that we have to know what exactly the intent here. He says, the big question is, if it's not written, as you talk to the modern day attorneys, if you have something that it's understanding, it can be a hearsay evidence. In order to execute any matter, at least in the court system, you need to have some written evidence. So that's, anyway, the big disputation, the way the Chabad Da'at put it is, for example, if someone said, look, I hire you, and I hire you with the condition that if you'll get sick, I'll pay you X amount of money for the sick days, vacation days, 6 days. And you didn't get sick. So in some companies, they pay you anyway for certain days, days off, days vacation, days sick, whatever you call it, right? But the point is, you cannot go after that person and said, oh, since I didn't get sick, or since I didn't feel so well, but I did not declare sick, so now I want that money. Right? Now, it's a question that we mentioned in the past, the great Rogochover. Rogochover was one of the super shrewd, lenient, ingenious rabbi in the past generation. So the question posted to him in Russia, in the old Russia. So it was a rule that everyone needs to go to serve in the army. It wasn't even a question. But it was in the old Russia way that you pay X amount of money to get a special paper, a special permission, cost tons of money, and you get exemption if you pay that. So it was a man that bought that, and he have a growing children, only one child left in the age of army services. So he took that paper of exemption and he gave it to that son. That son figured out in the army, when you drafted, when you go there, they always have a lottery. So he figured out, I'll go to the lottery if I won, so I'm free from the service, I'm going to sell this promissory note, it costs a lot of money, to someone else. If they want to draft me, I'll give them this note and I'll be free. Sure enough, he went there and he won the lottery. He was the one who selected not to go to service. So now, his brother sued him to rabbinic court, to the Rogochover, why he wants to sell that and take all the money for himself. The brothers came in and they said, wait a second, Dad left you this in order to exempt you from the army. She said, what do you mean? If I didn't go for the lottery, I use it and I don't have it. They said, no, you are using it if you do not win the lottery. But since you applied the lottery and you won the lottery, so we want that to be divided equally to all the brothers. You see the same here with the sugya we're going to study with the daughters. It's a state of situation that the father left a will And the rabbi said that even the sons inherited, the daughters that not married, the father have to leave 10% to them. And now if it's more than one daughter, one married, one not married, the question is, how do you divide the part that left? One daughter said to the other, look, that question, by the way, posted to Moshe Feinstein, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, too. So the daughter that married, she says, I want to use that. And dad left it to you only if you get married. You stay by his house, you're not getting married. It's not fair that you take that part. I have my children, I have my family, I want to take part of that. It's a discussion. So Tashma, the Itma. Mi she'niach, mi she'met, ve'niach shte banot uve. So biblically speaking, the Gemara in Bava Batra 115 said, based on the Torah, Book of Bamidbar, chapter 27, the son inherited the estate of the father, the daughters not. The sages come in and said that they can collect from the estate of the father if it's part of the ketubah condition until they get married or until they reach the age of maturity, which was the 12 and a half, that's Gemara Ketubot 52. So when it's come to nourishment, the sages said that when the daughter get married, she collect the dowry from the estate. Isu nechasim. Anyway, so they said Misha met veniach shte banot uben vekadma rishona avnet la isu nechasim velo ispika shniya likbot ad shemet aben amar Rabbi Yochanan shniya vitra. ואמר לרבי חנינה, גדולה מזו אמרו, מוציאים לפרנסה, ואין מוציאים למזונות. ואת אמרת, שנייה ויתרה. So, it was a great rabbi by the name of Rabbi Yaakov Bloy. He asked a question, when it's come even to pay expenses, so Moshe Feinstein said, you cannot use Maser Kesafim, the tithe, for paying tuition, because you have the obligation, v'shinantan levanecha. But when it's come to marry the children, so Rabbi Yaakov Bloy brought a posuk, brought a line from the book of Yirmiyahu, Jeremiah. The posuk said, ve'ed bnotechem, yiyu l'anashim, the youth daughters shall marry. So the big question is that a chiyuv or not? Is that the obligation? The father need to pay the expense? Anyway. והפרנסה, דמיקץ קיצה. But isn't the dowry mentioned by Rabbi Hanina, which is the dowry in which an orphan daughter is entitled from her father's estate of a fixed amount, which means one-tenth of the estate, נכתב לכתיבה וכמוציאה. It's not written, but nevertheless, the way that Rabbi Hanina explains, it can be appropriated from the lien property that has been sold to another property. So the Gemara said, Shani Parnasa. Shani Parnasa. So the dunya, the dowry is different from other collected. Kevan de itla kala. Because the moment the Meiri explains, the Ritva, Rashi, the moment the father passed away, everyone knows that each of the daughter will take 10% of the estate. So since it generates publicity, keman dichtiva adami, it's considered that was written. So if you talk about other situations, so according to Rabbi Hanina, it may be that the obligation be both of a fixed amount and written. But here is different. Mativ Rav Huna Bar Manoach. So the Gemara tried to prove that the fixed death you can collect from a lien property even it's not written. Mativ Rav Huna Bar Manoach. So this is a Mishnah in Tractate Ketubot, page 101, and dealing in a situation that Reuven married a woman, and he committed himself to take care of the daughter of his wife for 5 years. After 5 years, he divorced her, and she went and married Shimon, second man. Shimon committed himself to take care of the first daughter 5 years. So the additional years of these two commitments, one of the husbands needs to take care of the daughter, and the other one needs to pay the money in equal of that expense. They said, "Metu bnotehem nizonot min chasim nechorim, vehi nizonet min chasim shuabadim ipnei shei kebalat chov." So she considered like that of a creditor, and therefore she has the right to collect the debt from property formerly owned by her stepfather, the one who owed the money. So they said, "Acha b'maya skinan bekanu miyadu," that each of them receive a kinyan from each of the owner. So therefore, you cannot bring a proof from here that even a death that was not written, you can collect from a lien estate. And therefore, it's not a question of the view of Ula. So the Gemara said, "Yachei banot name." If that's the case, the daughter as well should be entitled to collect the sustenance from a lien property that has been sold to a third party. So they said, "Bekanu, b'shekanu lazo, v'lo kanu lazo." So that the edim acquire for the daughter of the wife, and not the daughter of one of the husbands. So therefore, she only collected from a lien property. So the Gemara said, "My paska." What's the reason that the Tana make a decision to divide it in this way? The one is go by the kinyan, the daughter is without. Bat ishto dahavai bishat kinyan mehanei la kinyan. Bito delo havai bishat kinyan lo mehanei kinyan. So again, here we say that if you go by the one who is alive at the time of the acquisition, when he gave the mother her marriage contract, the act of acquisition is effective for her. But his own daughter from his mother, who is not alive at the time of the act of acquisition, the act of acquisition is not effective for her. So the Gemara refuted that. Milo askinan dehavu travaihu bishat kinyan. So Rashi explained, I explained in my book, klomar milo mashma nami matnit kingo deave bandate bishat kinyan, which means that the both of them at that time, that's bestam. But the way that Rashi, I understand the duke here, and the Braita was written Pashtut, and you can learn also Vegam, Girsha Ve'Adra. So there are both of them was at the time of Sh'at Kinyan. You're welcome to read more in my book. Anyway, so they said Ve'echei Dami, that a person commit himself to his wife during the marriage to take care of the daughters, the Girsha. After they have daughters, he divorced her. Ve'ahadra. Ela, bito de bitnai bedin kachla. The Gemara explained the difference between his daughter that only have from Bnei Chorin and the daughter of the wife that go for only Meshabadim in the estate that was subjugated from the Koach HaKinyan. So it says, bito de bitnai bedin kachla. She have the condition of Nai Bednin. That's the idea that the rabbi said that the person should take care of his daughters after his passing. Even he didn't write it clearly, as Gemara Ketubot 52 said, in the Shtar Ketubah with his wife. So that's a different story. But that's the Ibn Ezra in 112. But anyway, lo me'ane le'kinyan. Bat ishto de'lav bitnai bedin ka'achla me'ane le'kinyan. Because the whole condition she leaves is by the stipulation of the court. So entitlement is based on the explicit stipulation made between the husband and the wife. So the Gemara asks, "V'chimigra gra'a?" But is it a right that rooted in two sources, both a stipulation of the court and the act of acquisition inferior to the right that is rooted in the act of acquisition alone? The act of acquisition is an addition to the stipulation of the court and should be effective for her as well. Ela bito kevan de betnai bedin ka'achla eimar tzrarei atapsa. Because she have this condition of the bedin, so based on the stipulation of the court, they say that perhaps he already gave her money during a lifetime for her sustenance. So it's because we're not sure, that's the issue. So the daughter of the wife, it's not part of the Chiyuvei Beitnai Beidin. So therefore, you don't have the concern that maybe he gave her that money. Tashma. Amar Rabbi Natan, Ei Matai, Bizman Shekadam Mikacho Shel Sheni Lishvacho Shel Rishon. אבל קדם שבחו של ראשון למקחו של שני, גובה מנכסים משועבדים. על מה? משום דלא קדים הוא. Because the שבח is not for the second one. תנאי דתניא, אין מוצאים לאכילת פירות ולשבח קרקרות ולמזון אישה והבנות מנכסים משועבדים מפני תיקון העולם, לפי שהם כתובים. אומר רבי יוסי, וכי מה תיקון העולם יש בזו, והלא הם קצובים. So he said, so that's the disputation, that Ula hold the same as Tanakama, that you don't collect any chov that's not written. Rabbi Hanina hold Rabbi Yossi, the same Rabbi Yossi, you don't have a clear fix of that, so you don't collect it. Ramotze Metzia, someone found, and not everything returned, lo yishava. Doesn't need to make a note that he returned whatever he found. Omar Rabbi Yitzchak, Shnei kisim kshurim matzata li. Vala omer lo matzati ela echad. It reminds me of the story I think I told you about I was sitting in JFK once and some large, tall Afro-American came to me and offered me tefillin shel rosh, brand new. And I said, what is the second? What is the pair? He says, that's the only one I have. I said, what do you mean? It's not a product. You have a half. And I was afraid that he's going to trash it, so I bought it from him. But it's basically clearly right. Stolen. But anyway, שני כיסים מצאת לי, ועלה אומר לו, מצאתי לה אחד, נשבע. Found one. So needed, שני שברים קשורים מצאת לי, ועלה אומר לו, אלה אחד, אינו נשבע. מה הייתה, מה? שברים מנת חיידה, כיסים לא מנת חיידה, when it comes to ox, become detached from each other. So it's possible that when the oxen were lost, there has been two that were tied together, but afterward they become separated and finder found only one. By contrast, pouches do not become detached from each other. Since the finder admits that he found one of them, it stands to reason that he actually found both of them. זה סל שני שברים קשורים מצאתי, אבל אומר מצאתי והחזרתי לך אחד מהם, הרי זה נשבע. ורבי יצחק לדלה מוציא מציאה לא יישבע מפני דיכון העולם. 51, ביהודה אמר כרבי אלעזר בן יעקב. So if the Baal Avedah, the lost, have טענה ודאית, declare against the one who receives, so it's not exempt from all. ותנא רבי אלעזר בן יעקב, פעמים שאדם נשבע על טענת עצמו כיצד, מנה לאביך בידי ויכלתיו פרס, הרי זה נשבע. וזהו שנשבע על טענת עצמו, וחמורים אינו כמשיב עבדה הוא פטור. So again, you have to differentiate between a return of lost item that exempts from taking an oath, versus if they said that I owed, for example, 100 zuz, and I gave a half, so then is the category of modeh b'miktzad that agree with some. Rabbi Eliezer ben Yaakov leit lemishim avodah patur, marav v'toano katan, this is minor. So katan midid v'mashash ha'id bei, ve'atnan, this is a Mishnah in Shavuot 38, en nishbaim al tanat chere shoteh v'katan, they said that one does not take an oath in response to a claim of a deaf mute shoteh, imbecile or a minor, as the claim of one who lacks halachic competent is no significant whatsoever. So they said, "Mai katan, gadol, v'mai kara lekatan, gabe mi ledeavim katanu," because it's not so familiar. Yache tanat atzmo, tanat acharimu. So they said, "Tanat acharim v'odat atzmo." So the Gemara said, "Kulo tan taname, tanat acharim v'odat atzmo ninu ela." Bide Rabba Kamif Ligeda. Amar Rabba, Mnei Ma'amra Torah Modem Miktzad Atana Yishava. Why the Torah requires someone who admitted for part to make an oath? Chazaka Nadam Meiz Pana Bifnei Baal Chovom. We assume only, because people are sometimes horrible, but the Gemara in Bava Kama, in 107, is Rashi there, they said, either because the lender gave him the money, did the favor, or because the lender know that he lies, the Tosfot said. Anyway, ve'ay bechul lebay limichpelei ve'ay lo kafri mishum dey mazam mizpanav lifnei ba'al chobo ubechul lebay delo delay ve'ay delo ko delay ishtamu deyu kan mishtamet lei k'zavar ad avu lizuz v'parano li until I have a money I can pay her v'amar rachman adamei remi shvua elave you impose the oath on him k'yachad lelo lebay kule in order to agree. So since he's not, we not suspected him to be a thief of that sum of money, we don't assume that he is lying in court. Rabbi Eliezer ben Yaakov sevar lo shnabo v'lo shnabivno eno meiz. Vilkach lav mashiv avodahu v'ravna svir ebo hu deno meziz, v'vifno meiz u v'deno meiz mashiv avodahu, and therefore he is exempt from taking an oath. So the Chtam Sofer, we have to conclude, he was in the Bar Mitzvah of the son of Ktav Sofer. So ask a question, it's written, Ru'e banim levanecha shalom al Yisrael. Ru'e betuv Yerushalayim kol mechayecha. Ru'e banim levanecha shalom Yisrael. So what's the connection between Yerushalayim and Ru'e banim levanecha? So we bring a Tosfot Bava Batra. They said that the Yerushalayim chubra yachdav, special kedusha, special sanctity. So they used to go there, and then when they return, Gdolim chuzrim, they return home, so they bring the two Yerushalayim, they behave properly, you look at the Torah, look at the good deeds. So it's publicized that the two Yerushalayim. So there's a connection between the two Yerushalayim and Ure Banim Levanecha.